Walla Vlogs, episode 135. Mizzle and Mac out here in Ivor, Virginia with the Johnson of Johnson Rottweiler Kennels. The Johnsons were nice enough to invite Batman and I to their home and talk about their passion for the Rottweiler breed. Please give the video a thumbs up. It's very important that you do that. And as always, enjoy the content.
Hi, this is Corey Johnson with Johnson Rottweiler Kennels. We're in Ivor, Virginia. This is the spot where it goes down. We breed these beautiful Rottweilers. This is my wife, Sabrell. This is my partner in crime, my helpmate. This is the person, the backbone behind our business. My first time I fell in love with the breed was, we would go stay with my dad in Richmond for like summers when we was out of school. And we would go stay with my dad, and my dad, he used to do paper routes, delivering mail and flowers and stuff like that. And he used to drop me and my sister off at my brother's house. And he will always call, my first time going, he would call in, and my brother's name is Jack. He'd be like, "Hey Jack, put the dog up." And I used to be like, "What kind of dog is this?" He always called. And first couple of times I didn't see the dog, I just always heard about the dog. So I finally seen the dog, and it was a Rottweiler. His name was Caleb. When I said, you know, back then I was little, so back then that dog was huge. Like
back then, like what we talking, what year was this probably?
Oh man, this had to have been like late 90s, like okay. 98, 99, okay.
All right.
Something like that. But man, this dog was huge, man. And this dog actually chased my brother. Actually, almost bit him. Like, but this dog, like, I was starstruck when I seen this dog, man. How it protect the family, and you know, the markings, how big it was. Like, I was just starstruck. Rottweilers was my thing from that day. Caleb was more of a family dog,
okay.
But he knew who his family was.
Okay.
Like my brother, his wife, and his kids, and that was pretty much it. Everybody knew he was not to be played with. Like, if you didn't stay there, you didn't mess with Caleb.
So, but you, even though you was a little afraid of him, you were still intrigued by the breed.
Yeah,
What intrigued you? Was because, like, oh, this, my older brother has this breed. I want to be like my older brother. What was it that was like?
It was the turn up and the turn down for me. Like, I'm like, man, this dog can turn up just like this. But in a second, if he's, you know, he's with family, like, he's like a big teddy bear. You know, I was like, that's what I want. You know, I wanted something that knew me, knew my family, you know. But at the same time, if it felt threatened by, you know, somebody being around the house, like, it knew how to turn up. That's what I want. I grew up with Mutt. My granddaddy had a dog, and that's pretty much what I grew up around, his dog. And it was pretty much the same thing, but that was a one-man dog. Like, that dog, like, nobody but him. Like, everybody knew, matter of fact, everybody knew that came to the church. Like, my grandma would host these summer feeding programs for all the kids in Ivor or wherever you came from, you know, Cortland, whatever, wherever you came from, you was allowed to come to the church and, you know, feed you, you know, recreation, come outside, play basketball. But every now and then, Fluffy will break the chain and everybody just go haywire. Like, and nobody would mess with that dog. Like, so that kind of got me started, like, you know, wanted to get more with dogs. And, you know, the process of getting my own mutts, you know, I started out with, I don't even know what the first dog I had. Like, I can't tell you what it was mixed with, but I love the dog. I actually, that was like the start of me, you know, liking dogs.
Hey, I gotta ask you, what was this dog mixed with? His name was Fluffy. Cause Fluffy, I mean, he's breaking off the chain, running out of people at the church. His name needed to be Cujo.
I knew that, all right, I want a Rottweiler now. So I started researching, you know, the beginner researching, sending Instagram pictures. That's the big thing now. Facebook pictures of, you know, guys that had nice dogs on Facebook and Instagram. And yeah, I just went from there. Like, I didn't go into depth pretty much per se like I should have as far as researching. It was just more of a fact of, you know, sending pictures and things like that.
So you was like going off a look that you wanted.
Right.
Okay,
right.
So it was a certain type of look. What was the look that you was like looking for? Like, what was you looking for?
I can't even, at that time, it wasn't a specific, yeah, it was a more of a, honestly, I just really wanted one, and I grew to learn that's not the way to go. But yeah, our first dog, Roxy, she was beautiful in our eyes, you know. But we grew more after her. Like we learned a lot more after her. Roxy definitely changed both our mindsets. Man, we really dug in after we lost Roxy, and we did some heavy researching, and that's what kind of Roxy would kind of got us started where we at now.
I can say Roxy, she was my girl from the moment like we went to go pick her up, and she came to me like she was the first one that came to me, and that's what made me want to choose her, and he agreed. So we brought her home, you know, everybody fell in love with her, and you know, she quickly grew up, and like all Rottweilers, they have a little cute side, but Roxy was feisty.
Yeah.
So we did the best we knew how to do at the time with Roxy. We were ignorant to the fact that a lot of things could go wrong, and we didn't know. I know some things can't be prevented, but I wish that we would have learned more, maybe saw some signs, or you know, she may have needed some attention that we didn't give. But like Corey said, after her, we watch video. I don't even watch Rottweiler videos. I watch videos of, you know, help keeping up on the health of a dog, and you know, are there any signs before a heart attack that can be prevented or seen? Like we dug in all the time, talking about it all the time. Like, so we knew when we got another one, it wouldn't happen again if we could do anything about it.
And most importantly, this might help some of you breeders out there. Most important, we got a mentor. So that's what helped us out a lot. I can go ahead and say her name. Her name is Linda Harris. Like she still to this day comes here, or we go to her house and she mentors us. Like, you're not gonna know it all. And she has years and years and years and years and years in the business. And she knows all about this breed, the Rottweiler. And she mentors us and kind of like took us under her wing, and we appreciate her for that. So Ms. Harris, if you see this video, we appreciate you. Thank you. The day she passed, I actually went with my one of my homeboys, and he got the dog named Tank, which is the dark mahogany male I have right now. He got him the same day she passed. So we had got her. That's the day I met my mentor, Ms. Harris. Like, our relationship hadn't really established yet. So we came back here, and we were both playing with the dogs, and that's when I was was unfortunate how I lost Roxy. She had a heart attack, but that's the day I got Tank, and that's the day I met Miss Harris. And from that day, I was calling her, hey, what happened to my dog? You know, even though I didn't get the dog from her, I was calling her like, hey, what happened to my dog? And what made me start calling her more and wanting her to be my mentor, she didn't hesitate wanting to help me, even though, you know, it wasn't about the money with her. It wasn't about, you didn't get the dog from me, so I can care less. Like, she was trying to genuinely help me and inform me and help me out, like, what happened to my dog. So that's what kind of established our relationship that day. She was the first person I reached out to, you know, for help. And you know, she welcomed me with open arms. I appreciate her. You know, I didn't really have to go around, you know, trying to find a mentor, or you know, people telling, you know, really not trying to deal with me or whatever the case may be. She opened me with welcome arms. I appreciate her. I got Tank from one of my homeboys, Carlos Batten. So Carlos, if you're watching this, I appreciate you, man. Yeah, I got him from him. He was actually here, like I said. They was both here the day that my dog died. That's the day Carlos had got Tank. So how I got Tank was my friend, Carlos had to have back surgery. So pretty much in that time frame where Tank was still, you know, young, and he had him in the house trying to potty train him. So it was pretty much a little bit too much for him at the time. So he gave me the opportunity. He called me, and he knew how devastated I was too about losing my dog. And he was like, hey man, if you want Tank, man, just give me what I paid for him, man. He all yours. So I said, okay, bet, shoot. I think that very next day, I went over there. It was a Saturday morning. He called me on Friday. I went over there that Saturday morning and got him. I was like, sure you want to sell him? He was like, yeah, man. He's like, I can't, you know, with my back. So I was like, appreciate it, man. I took him. I brought him home. And of course, I took her to her mom's house so she could see him. She was still devastated over Roxy. So she was like, what are you bringing this dog over for? You trying to replace Roxy already? I'm like, no. you know, Carlos, you know, he can't take care of him, so I just want him to have a good home. You know, I took that approach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was not a fan of Tank at all. Like, when he brought him to the house, he was cute. You know, he went, took him to the groomers, got a little scarf on him, trying to present him to me. And I'm like, I'm not happy at all, because I was still fresh on Roxy. Like I said, that was my first dog that I got attached to, and to lose her. And, like, it was maybe, what, a month later?
It was like 2 weeks.
Not even a whole month later, we got Tank. So I wasn't happy at all. I'm like, give him back. They'll have to deal with him. I don't want him at all.
So I actually called Carlos, and I asked him. We went to a gathering together, and I asked him, I said, man, you want a dog back, man? I don't think Brill really feeling him. So he was like, no, man, yours, man, you know what, man? So I kind of worked on Brill, you know, kind of bringing him around when I go see her, stuff like that, and Tank won over.
Yeah.
So eventually, Carlos ended up asking for him back, and I was like, man, Brill ain't gonna let me get rid of that dog now. Yeah.
That was my big baby.
It was too late.
Yeah.
Nice.
Carlos gave me the opportunity, and my cousin LJ, which is one of his friends too, he gave us the opportunity to go with him to pick this dog out. So when me and LJ seen this dog, we was like, man, we ain't never seen one like that before. Get that one. So Carlos, he was still looking around like he didn't want to listen to us, but he knew he wanted to listen to us. So he picked that dog, man, and right then I knew, like, I had never seen a dark Rottweiler. Like, I had never seen it before. So I knew right away, like, that dog is going to be a game changer. Yeah. Yes.
So over time, did you develop more and more passion for the deep dark mahogany marking Rottweilers?
Yeah, I did. Actually, at the time, I still didn't really understand what I had. So my cousin, Brent Bird, he's actually a breeder too. I used to take him up there so he could see him, you know, just to get, you know, kind of, you know how breeders do, or guys mm-hmm. that got Rottweilers. We like to get other guys that got Rottweilers approval, like, you know, how my dog look, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I used to take him up there, and, man, he used to tell me all the time, man, he's like, this is the most beautiful Rottweiler I've seen. He was like, Corey, you got something. You got a game changer. So I started, of course, doing my research and seeing how rare that was for to have a dark mahogany Rottweiler. I was like, man, I'm so blessed, man. I thank, you know, my friend Carlos for giving me the opportunity to get him, because he could have sold him to anybody else or took it back to the breeder he got it from. So I appreciate it. The first lot I had with Tank, man, I looked at those puppies and knew right away, like, man, Tank, his genetics, his gene, like, he puts his marks on his puppies. Like, when Tank have a litter, you know they his puppies, man. Those jokers are dark. Like, and if, you know, if it's one puppy that slid away from that mahogany gene, most of the time it's just one, two at best. Tank really, when he does his thing, he does his thing, man.
How big was the litter? You remember the first litter?
Tank first litter was eight.
Eight puppies. Out the gate. Came out swinging.
Yes, sir.
Real strong.
Real strong. Yes,
yeah.
Sir.
Those eight puppies were huge. We have a bigger female than the mother of Tank's first litter, and the smaller dog's litter was bigger in size, and I was amazed. Like, I was working at the time, so I didn't get to spend as much time during the first days as Corey did. So he would send me pictures while I was at work, and I'm like, that's not true. Like, those puppies are too big to come from Diva and Tank, but they look just like Tank. Like, wow. Like you said, Tank is tall. Those puppies,
They were tall and big, huge.
And most of them were dark in color. So, yeah, Tank has strong genes for sure.
Well, I wanted to ask you, because you said something about you was working at the time. Explain you guys' dynamic of how you guys work together for your kennel, because it's not Corey Rottweiler Kennels, it's Johnson Rottweiler Kennels.
Right.
So it's the two of you guys together. So talk to me a little about the roles that you play, whether you're helping whelp the puppies or, you know, you're... What roles you guys are playing here?
Wow. Well, I know for me, when I'm home, this is what I do. Like, I take care of the dogs, but I'm only as good as my wife. Like, she's the backbone of what we do. Like, she digs in, she's not afraid, pick up poop, get in the kennels. Like, she you know, she's not afraid when, you know, whipping puppies, you know, worming them, giving them shots.
I was working. I was full-time in the school system. And I used to joke with my coworkers, and I used to say, I'm going to be a stay-at-home wife. And they're like, for what? What you going to do all day? And I'd be like, I'm going to take care of the dogs. But little did I know, like, when the pandemic started, that I would be home taking care of the dogs. And when it was time to go back, I talked to Corey. He agreed, and I stayed home. So I stayed here for our very first litter. I was there. We were both there, but that was my first time ever seeing something like that. So it was amazing to me, and I'm like, okay, I can do this full time. So I just kind of, like Corey said, dug in. He coaches me a lot on things to do and things to not do, because I have my little own little shortcut methods, and he like he's like, that's not gonna work for us. But yeah, I don't have any problem doing anything. I love it. I could do this all day long, honestly.
What gives you gratification with being a breeder? Because this is not anything you're going to get rich quick on. You know, like, this is, you're going to take more losses than you're going to have wins. Absolutely. And I'm pretty sure you guys have been through that.
Yes.
You're going to be frustrated. There's going to be smells that, you know, for me, I'm a neat freak. So, you know, the dog's making a mess and stuff like that. What keeps you two going to want to keep doing this? What's driving you?
For me, it's preserving the Rottweiler look and Tank especially. You know, that dark mahogany Rottweiler, man. And fast to rewind a little bit, you know, as I explained how I first got Roxy, I thought, you know, your first Rottweiler, you know, it's the best thing smoking, right. You know. So doing my research and actually getting a good quality dog, you know, it's preserving that look, man, and actually seeing customers, you know, good people come here and seeing them go to happy families and kids, man. It's no better feeling when those puppies ready to go home and see, you know, the owners come and get them and see how happy they are to add that family member to their family. And, you know, a lot of people come, you know, they actually had Rottweilers before. Some never had Rottweilers before. But just to see them go to happy homes and, you know, people be happy, bring that extra joy to somebody's life.
Yeah, nice. That's my favorite part too of breeding. It's just seeing the puppies grow up, and to know that that came from your stock, it kind of makes me excited. Cause Tank's first litter, which was our previous litter, they look so amazing. And we have one person who always sends us pictures, and she's like, I hope I'm not bothering you. I'm like, no, like, send them all the time, because I miss them when they're gone. But just to know that people actually love them, take care of them, and they respect us enough to know, like, okay, we might want updates. So they send them, and we see how much they've grown, how much they're changing. It's amazing.
It is amazing.
What advice do you have for people who's coming up?
The advice I have for people that's coming up is, number one, do your research on the breed. Do your research on what you're trying to get into, and get a mentor. Don't be afraid to ask, because you don't know it all. I still don't know it all. It's a lot more learning I have to do and want to do. So do your research, get a mentor, and be willing to learn.
Yeah, and I would definitely say make sure you're ready to put in the work, because a lot of people see it and say, oh, I want to breed, I want to do it. But it's not a cakewalk. Like, it's not just waking up and feeding the dogs and giving them water. It's a lot of waking up at 6 o'clock because all of your dogs are playing, and it's time for you to get up and get to work. And I'm outside all day long, and not just because I have to, but because I choose to do right by our dogs.
Absolutely.
But it's not
that's easy, a very good point.
Yeah, it's not an easy thing. So I'll just tell them, make sure you're ready to do the work. And like Corey said, make sure you do the research, because you don't want to get into it and you're not doing all that you can to do right by the breed.
Man, Mike, I appreciate you, man. What you're doing, man, is amazing, man. Nobody else is doing this, especially for this breed. As we know, it used to be a dying breed, and it's now coming back, and people are starting to get more informed. And one of those reasons is because of you. You actually taking the time out, and you're traveling, man. You're traveling, and you going right in people's living rooms, backyards, and you giving us an opportunity to show our dogs and put out good information. I appreciate you for that, and I see big things for you, man.
Thank you. I appreciate you guys being on Rottweiler Vlogs. Thank you.
Yes, sir. So how you can find me is Facebook, Johnson Rottweiler Kennels. And my number is up there, but I can tell you now, 757-274-5925. You can also find me on Instagram, johnson.rotties.
Nice. Well, I appreciate you guys being on Rottweiler Vlogs, episode 135. This is your episode. So
Thank you. I appreciate you guys being here. Appreciate it.
Yes,
sir.